but to stop reliance on nuclear energy. You know, nuclear energy used to contribute 10 or 11% in 2010 to electricity. But now, as a result of the disaster in Japan, the German government has taken the wise decision to close down all nuclear energy plants by 2023. So the reliance or the contribution of nuclear energy usage has gone down from 10.9% in 2010 to 26.9%. But whilst the Germans and the Japanese are winding down, somehow the Malaysian government is ramping up. Because they tend to build not one, but two nuclear energy reactors. And that somehow is beyond me. I see my good friend Dr. Mofaza, and he's one of the main opponents of building nuclear energy plants in Asia. Just for your information, Penang has taken a very strong stand on this. We stand together with our German energy experts. We are the first state in the country, the only state so far, the first state in the country to oppose the building of nuclear energy plants in Penang. And we've got a reply from the federal government saying that they would not build. Contrary to our wishes, because we have the right, of course, to decide. They will not be building any nuclear energy plants in Penang. So you don't have to worry, you are safe from any radioactive fallout. But the problem is that we should be responsible. Our neighbors are nearby. We really cannot bear up. Actually, my good friend is about to learn. We will be contacting them. So, we are asking the federal government, learn from the experts in the most scientifically advanced countries in the world. I'm not talking about the United States. I'm referring to Germany and Japan. If two of the most scientifically advanced countries in the world feel that nuclear energy cannot be controlled safely, how can Malaysia, with such a poor safety record, decide to build not one, but two nuclear energy reactors? I think that is somehow doesn't make sense. So we are definitely together on the same page with our young advisor who opposes the building of nuclear power plants, and we hope that we will see some sense and stop this rather crazy adventure, because we don't see good coming out of it, especially when we do not have a good safety record, you know. Even building roofs, even building stadiums, also the roof collapses. So don't talk about nuclear energy plants. It's not funny anymore. Now we have a vision of making Penang greener and safer. Of course, we're working very hard towards making Penang the first green state in the country. We have the highest recycling rate of 32% compared to the national average of only 10.5%. So we are 3 times better than the national average, and we intend, of course, to make it even better. We are the only state that has no plastic bag rulings, no free plastic bag rulings, and of course, we hope that our success can show that actually going green can be very profitable and very safe. So we intend to learn from our German counterparts, and of course, Germany has a very close link with Penang. Dr. Anwar Faisal was telling me that you look at the history and the contributions of the German community in Penang. It is not just related to recent investments from German companies, be it Bosch, Austral, or you mentioned Infineon. I think not just these companies. Actually, there's a coffee table book called More Than Just Merchants, which traces the contributions of the German community, of German merchants in the 19th century. Some of the roads were actually named after German merchants, like Boston Road. Now I think it's gone on. Boston Road. It was named after German merchants. And I think they have got a very long historic history. Probably the time of Faisal can introduce. Now I just want to reply to a few concerns that were expressed by Mr. Eastman just now. Number one, the 75% rate, where the export earnings have to be converted to really within about 6 months, 2 weeks. But you have to convert to global currency. I actually brought it up with the Minister of International Trade, actually, Mustafa Muhammad. And he said that we were looking at it from the national interest. But we've got to make sure our currency is stable. Of course, I don't quite agree. Because when they first implemented the 75% ruling, ringgit was at 4 to 4, 10 to the US dollar. After they implemented, it went down to 4.5. So it doesn't really help. Of course, they will say that if we had not implemented the ruling, it may have gone down to 4.8 to the US dollar. So this is something that we are still trying to ask for some sort of relaxation of the 75% ruling. And we know that this is drag on for foreign investors, and we think that we hope that good sense will prevail, because the ringgit depreciation is not due to currency holdings. I think it's more because of the reputational risk caused by the one and the second. Because this is something we will never admit. But I think if we can address that squarely, I'm sure that the ringgit will go back to its natural level of around 3.8. But not for one energy scandal where international confidence is completely shredded because of that scandal. That's why the ringgit is not doing as much as it is. These are recent talk about favorable trade balance in Malaysia. We have got 12.3 billion euros to a trade, which is in favor of Malaysia. I sometimes am surprised because I see so many Mercedes and BMWs and Porsches on the streets. I would thought that that would be in Germany similar. But apparently it's not enough. So, we have to buy probably more. Give us some discounts. We can get more Mercedes and Porsches. Maybe more discounts. Ordinary. So I think it's this is something that we should have to go, and we are very we are a fan of Germany. German technology, German discipline, German philosophy, everything German. You know, even the Michael Faisal is one of the international ambassadors for one of the 8 international ambassadors, and the only Malaysian that Michael Faisal here. So as I said, there is a lot of interaction and context between the Penangites and Germany, and we also have continued Dr. Sri Hui, who is a conductor. She's a conductor. She's actually staying and living in Bonn, and she's a conductor there, and she makes a lot of regular trips here. So we hope that we can have greater links. And today's exhibition, I think, is wonderful because we should be going towards renewable energy. We learned FIT from Germany. We adopted the FIT system, but the only problem is the quantum is too small. How much can you convert with 300 million or 500 million? It's just too small. I think they should do it in a massive way. The problem is now they're trying to go nuclear. I think that is the step right now. RE, we got a lot of sun. I think it's got illumination all year round. And I think Malaysia has one of the highest illumination rate of more than 90%. Wind, well, it's wind. We have a lot of radiation here, so it's a lot of wind. Hot air, probably. And RE, I think RE biomass, that's one area. Of course, we cannot compare with Germany. You know, your beer is excellent. So I think that's a very natural resource. Talking about beer, we always look forward to the October Fest. And Penang has, I think, the liveliest and most energetic October Fest in Malaysia. We do it for 2 nights. We hope under the able leadership of that governance, we do it for 3 nights. Okay, three nights. Okay. And you've got an excellent venue, of course, you've got many neighbors very well. So you can drink the night away. So, thank you very much for inviting us to this exhibition, and we hope that not only can we learn, we can probably adopt some of the measures. And once again, I think, as I said, the way forward is for RE and not for nuclear. And we are definitely on